So my plan is I'm going to talk a little bit about the build-up to the first passion and then the subsequent passions and how they've all changed before I talk a little bit about the Nottingham passion. The Nottingham passion was the fifth passion play I've done, and all have been variations on a theme, really. So it all began when my wife and I were, when we came back to faith, or when I came back to faith, we started worshipping at a church in Newark. And we got very involved in church life, but I think it's fair to say it was a church with quite a lot of problems. I mean, I'm sure you've never been part of a church where that's happened, but it was a church where there was some difficult stuff going on. And my wife, Rachel, and I essentially said to each other, what can we do to support the wider mission of this church, to frankly bring a bit of what we felt was God back into the environment, away from the contention and the difficulties? And because we both come from a theatre background, I was a theatre director, we proposed to the PCC that we put on a nativity play. It was fairly close to Christmas. And they said, that'd be great, but you haven't got very long, so why not put on a passion play instead? And I thought, yeah, all right, let's do that. Traditionally, I think when people think of passion plays, they think of the outside passion plays. So, for example, the one that just took place at Worcester, or the winter show that happened over in Trafalgar Square. They think of a large scale in a big square, or a traversing kind of, or traversal, a promenade style piece. But I was very clear that I wanted to do a passion play within the church itself. Part of my remit, part of the thing I wanted to do, was to bring people into the church building to show that actually this place is not full of contention. It's not the stuffy historical place that a lot of people think our churches are. You can come to church and experience something really powerful in a very, very different way. So it was a way of communicating the gospel message. And I've had this, always had the strap line of, it's for people with faith and those with none. If you have faith, it's an act of worship. If you don't have faith, then it's a great night out at the theatre. So the PCC kind of gave us their blessing. And very quickly on, I realised we had absolutely no money, really. Like a lot of churches, the budget we had was minute. And I've always had the belief that if you can't do something completely authentically, then don't even try, because there's nothing worse than people walking around with paper spears and really naff Romanesque costumes. That just it, the fact that they don't look realistic or believable detracts from the reality of what you're trying to portray. So in essence, what I'm saying, there's practicality informed vision. I think we always start, don't we? We always start with an artistic intent, but actually then we have to scale back. But in this case, very clearly, I had to adapt the vision of what we wanted the play to be, according to the resources we had at our disposal. So I was very clear from day one that I didn't want it to be your kind of your typical BBC epic costume drama style passion. A few people found that really difficult. I remember one very contentious elderly gentleman said, "Oh, well, if it's not going to be like that, then I hope it fails." So that was a really lovely, a really lovely start. I said it was a church with a few challenges. So the style that we went for, and this was in the Church of Newark, we described it as out of time. We described it as a timeless piece that had the hint of the era, but that essentially could be placed. It wasn't site or time specific. Now, clearly, the gospel is specific. The passion, the crucifixion, the resurrection happened at a particular time in history. But in terms of the visuals, what that enabled us to do, that liberated us from the need for expensive costumes, expensive props. It actually it freed us from the desire to have a full-blown crucifixion. It was a very stylized production, and I'll show more about that when we come to it. In terms of the script, when it came to actually writing the script, that was the biggest challenge. How do you write a passion play? Where on earth do you begin? I went through many different drafts. So I wrote it, I adapted it from the Gospels. We went through many different drafts. And the first few were genuinely appalling. I sent one of the first drafts that I was quite pleased with to a friend of mine. I just said, "Can you have a read of this? See what you think." And he just said, "It lacks poetry. You can do better than this." And it's so helpful and good to have a critical friend who actually can give you that robust honesty, because it's kind of people who say that and are that honest, that's when they pull you up, and that they're the people who make you do better. It hurts, but actually that's what you need when you're a creative person. So I went back and I really thought about this style, and I stripped it back. And the script that we came up with, I would say, was almost liturgical in its rhythm. The lines are simple. There's a weight behind them. They're not naturalistic. There's an intentionality in a sense, you wouldn't, they would almost fit within a normal Sunday morning Eucharist service. It's really hard to say what I mean by that, but hopefully when you see the clips, that you'll get a better sense. One thing I was very clear on early on is that I wanted music to be an important part of the production. And part of the challenges in the church were the relationships between people in the choir, people of the clergy, people in the wider congregation. And the plan was for the choir to, the organ master, the director of music, was going to write some music that the choir were going to sing. And that was kind of going to be weaved in throughout the play. Unfortunately, he ended up leaving. So I remember quite early on thinking, right, okay, where does this leave us? What do I do about music? And we hadn't started rehearsals. No, we had started rehearsals at this point. I think we were about a month into rehearsals by this point. And suddenly I was without music. And suddenly we had a play, we had a script, we had the actors. But there was a real thing of, what do I do about music? And I remember I was at a church youth group one night and I came walking home and a piece of music appeared on my iPad, on my iPod, as I was walking home from this youth group. And I suddenly went home and I thought, okay. I took that music track and I layered the voices and narration and dialogue over the top of it. And suddenly the style all fell into place. And the play developed a musical soundtrack in the same way that a film has a soundtrack to emphasize emotion, to emphasize characters. So our play has music that plays underneath almost constantly. There are gaps of silence. But if you imagine a film soundtrack, that's kind of the style we went for. And that had another impact on how we were performing the action. So a month into rehearsals, and we were casting from across both the local churches, non-churches, we were very clear that we wanted people in the Newark community who wanted to be involved. I'm a big believer that church is very good at rejecting people, consciously or unconsciously. And what I didn't want to do was say no to anybody. So basically, we had an open casting call and anyone who wanted to be involved could be involved. Let me just share the screen so you can see the original poster. So this is the poster image for the very first Passion play in Newark. And anyway, we were a month into rehearsals with a cast from across the town and we did our first full run through. And I came home that night and I said to my wife, this doesn't work. This play doesn't work. And she said, you're making it too layered. And she was absolutely right. We were trying to make it too dramatic, too clever, too pretentious. And what we did, we stripped all the movements back. We stripped the emotions right back and we allowed it to be purely storytelling. So as opposed to a Stanislavskian mold of becoming the character, we were more people who were kind of almost portraying the characters at a distance. That's not to say it was Brechtian or dispassionate, but actually there was a real sense of we were telling the story rather than trying to be that period naturalistic epic, if that makes sense. So we began rehearsing. And I remember there was one really profound moment where about a week before the performance, we ended up doing some workshops in various schools. And the crucifixion, as you'll see later on, is all done through stylized movement. Pontius Pilate is on stage. Caiaphas and Annas are on the floor. Jesus is in the aisle with his cross. And the crucifixion is done as Jesus processes down the aisle, carrying his cross with voices of narration over the top of the music. At various points, Jesus will stumble. So essentially, it's a very stylized piece with music and narration. And I said to these children in the workshop, what I want you to do, I want you to sit and close your eyes. And I just want you to imagine you're there. Listen to this music. Listen to these voices. Imagine you're there and just go with it. Feel what you feel. If you don't feel anything, that's fine. If you do feel something, that's fine. And at the end of these few minutes, after they'd listened to this track, they opened their eyes and this one little 9-10-year-old girl, she opened her eyes and she said, I can see why people believe. And that was really quite extraordinary. And that this little girl had that reaction. So I'm just going to show you a few images from the Newark Passion. So this is Sean. Sean played Jesus. And you can probably get a hint there what I'm talking about the style. So every single actor wore black shirt, black T-shirt, black trousers. And they all wore these outer robes that my wife made. She's never quite forgiven me for the amount of work. She said, I'll do them. And then she didn't realize, then she realized how many there were to actually make. So it gives the hint of the era. It gives the hint and the sense and the flavor, but there is a timelessness to it. So that's Jesus. That's the two high priests. And that's Jesus processing down with his cross, being comforted by his mother. We didn't know what this, how this was going to be received. We knew the reputation that the church had in the wider community. We didn't have a massive congregation. And come opening night, we'd sold about 50% worth of our tickets. And it's a big church. If ever you've been into St. Mary's in Nottingham, St. Mary's in Newark is of a similar size. So it's a big church. And if it only looks half full, it feels half full. So come opening night, we'd sold about half our tickets. And we thought, oh, well, we'll see what happens. And we went to open the doors at 7 o'clock. And people were queuing from the front door well into the marketplace. And over two nights, literally, I can only put it down to the grace of God and the work of the Holy Spirit, the church was heaving. One of the readers of the church, a wonderful lady who was in the cast, came to me and said in absolute amazement, this church has not been this full since the millennium. And this was 2010, we did this. So this church hadn't been this full since 2000, 10 years previously. And it was absolutely extraordinary. When we did, once we finished the Passion, there was a real sense of we want to do something more. We want to carry this on. So that then led us to doing the Nativity. And it was very clear from day one that I wanted the Nativity and the Passion to be back to be kind of the two halves of the same play. So they're both the exact same style. You could theoretically do the Nativity, have an interval, and then do the Passion, and you could have a good night of theatre. They are the same style. They use the same style of music. They use the same kind of costumes. I kind of want to find a way of doing the two together, but whenever you put them on, one of them is going to be out of season, which is slightly problematic. What was really interesting is when we came to doing the Nativity, again, for the most part, it was the same cast, but it was interesting how the Nativity and writing the Nativity informed changes for the next Passion play. So, for example, the Passion began with Jesus. We had four narrators on stage, and Jesus appeared. He just came off from the wings, and Mary, his mother, was on stage praying. They had a moment of embrace, and then Jesus kind of took over and did his opening monologue. When we did the Nativity ended with Mary and Joseph having the flight to Egypt and following the slaughter of the innocents. I was very determined we have that. But then it ended with Mary and Joseph looking out to the future, holding the baby Jesus. And then the adult Jesus walked up, stood on stage, turned and was baptized by John the Baptist. And then he turned to the audience and said, "Follow me and I will make you fishers of men," which was his opening line in the Passion. And what that then meant is that we then took that into when we next did the Passion, we rewrote the opening so that the end of the Nativity became the beginning of the Passion. So just as Jesus was baptized at the end of the Nativity, at the start of the Passion, he comes forward, is baptized, and then welcomes the disciples. So it's just really interesting how one production informs another. It's a constantly evolving process. Things kind of don't stay fixed. What I'm going to do, I'm going to play a little, just a clip from the end of the Nativity and the start of the Passion. So at the end of the Nativity when we did it in Newark and the start of the Passion when we did it in Silverminster.
And John the Baptist came as a witness to the light. He was not the light, but came to testify to the true light which was coming into the world.
You got the sense of how the two kind of informed the other, how one led to the other. So we did the Nativity in Christmas 2011. And at the time I was working as a verger at Southall Minster. And the dean, great man called John Gill, said to me, would you fancy doing the Passion that you did last year in Southern Minster, which is the cathedral for the Diocese of Sutherland and Nottingham? And of course, yes. I mean, who doesn't want to do a Passion play in a cathedral? And so we did, again, two nights, for the most part, the same cast as last time, although a few people couldn't do it, so we redid it. And again, it was just an extraordinary experience. If anyone's ever been to Southern Minster, it's a beautiful, beautiful cathedral, absolutely massive. And again, completely sold out. And I still don't quite know where those people came from, because Southern is a very rural cathedral. You know, it's not like St. Paul's, where you've got surrounded by tourists. People intentionally came, people of faith, people of no faith. And I think it's fair to say the impact it has on not just the audience, but on the actors. I remember the chap who played Peter in the Passion that we did in the Minster. I think he would describe himself as a lapsed Christian. And he was so moved by the experience of being in a Passion play that he went and spent the following summer in the Holy Land. And, you know, an extraordinary thing. I think at this point, I'm just going to pause for a minute and invite Simon to comment, who played Jesus when we just did it in Nottingham. Simon, I just wonder, it might be helpful for people, just from an acting perspective, as a member of a company, what that was like for you.
Jesus, from an acting perspective in Nottingham Passion, it's just an immense experience. I am a person of faith, and I was a person of faith when I went into the production. But I think it would be fair to say that I've been going through quite a difficult sort of period in my life and my family's life. And I had doubts and real kind of difficulty with my faith. And I wanted to be involved in a production which got me back into a church setting and doing something useful. And I think when I contacted James the first time, I was effectively saying, do you need any help? I can run a sound desk. I can design a program for you or something. I ended up reading for a number of parts and got Jesus. And then it gives you a lot of focus all of a sudden, because it's quite a big responsibility. And I just found it, and different people that play Jesus and different productions will tell you different things, I guess. But I just found the whole thing really immersive. And the story just gets to you. And it makes you think about life's big issues in a whole different way. My view of Jesus was obviously fully God, fully human, and he would have known joy and wonder and love and all those things, but also the absolute depths of human experience, so the pits of despair. He knew rejection, he knew rage, he knew anger, and in Gethsemane in particular, he gets to feel abandonment. So this sort of idea that Jesus has lived every type of human emotion, a human experience. And without being sort of really overbearing about it, that's quite, and for everybody in all of their particular, their parts as well, that's quite a big story to carry. And I got a real sense that audiences were just drawn into what was happening, irrespective of whether they had a faith or not. So one of my kind of memories, big memories of the performances was just a packed cathedral, but you could hear it at a pin drop. Everyone was just so absorbed with the story as it was being told, which tells you something about the power of the story and how it engages people. And I think that would be true to say of everyone else who was involved in that process, whichever part they were playing.
I think for me, you do it for an audience, but actually the people who get the most from it are those involved in it. And we've had, when we did it in Hucknall, which I'll come to in a few minutes time, the chap who played Jesus was an atheist, and you know what an extraordinary journey he went on. Now, he didn't suddenly find faith, but he said, I'm much more inclined to go along with you Christians now, or words to that effect. You know, what an extraordinary experience. And I hope, Simon, you don't mind me saying, but I remember seeing on your Facebook status, because we didn't know each other before you played Jesus. But I remember after it was cast, I kind of then saw what you'd put. And you'd said, I'm sitting in Nottingham Playhouse, which is where we had the auditions, about to audition for a Passion play in the hopes of finding my way back into some sort of faith life. And then you played Jesus. And you know, I think the journey you've been on has been wonderful. So thank you, Simon. If I just carry on a little bit. So we did the performance in Southern Minster. And if I just share the screen again. So they're just a few images. And again, we changed it. So one of the biggest changes, one of my favorite moments, is when we did it in Newark, the resurrection was almost a bit understated. The idea of Jesus was suddenly there amongst his disciples. The disciples were on stage, and I just had Jesus appear off the wings and almost kind of just be there. But then the head of lighting at Nottingham Playhouse, who's a friend of mine who I've worked with before, he ended up doing the lighting design and providing the kit for the show when we did it at Southall. And he said, that west door, which is the big door at the west end of the church, that would be an amazing thing to backlight for Jesus in the resurrection. And this was a perfect example. You can see that on the right-hand image. This is a perfect example where artistic coolness, frankly, overrode gospel integrity, because the power of the disciples being on stage and the power of having this massive west door open, flooded with light as the resurrected Jesus comes up. It might not be gospel accurate, but my word, that communicated something powerful about the resurrection. Absolutely an extraordinary moment. I'm just going to play for you the actual moment, the actual sequence of the crucifixion, because I think this gives you an idea of what I mean by stylized. It gives you a sense of how we did it. Again, I hasten to add, a video on Zoom, a video of a play, is never going to be the same scale or impact or power as actually having it live, but it gives you a flavor. I'm not going to play it all because we'll be here for a while, but it gives you a sense. So hopefully you can see this, of the crucifixion as happened in Southall Minster.
This man has done no wrong. If you will insist on his crucifixion, then his blood is on your hands.
In crucifixion, the victim is nailed to a wooden cross. The nails are driven at an angle into the victim's palms and feet. The length of time it took for the victim to die varied from a few hours to a number of days.
In Latin, the journey to Crucifixion Hill is called Via Dolorosa, known to us as the Stations of the Cross.
Jesus is condemned to death by Pontius Pilate.
He is given his cross.
Jesus stumbles and is supported by his mother.
The guards pull a man from the crowds. He helps Jesus.
But again, it's very stylized. It's very based in music. It's very rooted in just a sense of drama. There's also one. There is another clip I am going to show. Hopefully this will work. The essence of the gospel. How do you communicate the essence of the gospel in a passion play? And there's one moment in it for me which sums up what it's all about. And this is the moment where it's not the crucifixion, it's not the resurrection. There's the moment where Barabbas is released. There's this really powerful moment in the play where Jesus is in the aisle, Pilate's on stage, and the priests are trying to convince Pilate to condemn Jesus to death. And then Pilate turns and he says, I can release Barabbas or I can release Jesus. And as we know, Barabbas is released. And Barabbas is released and he walks down the aisle. And then as he passes Jesus, he holds the look and he just has this moment where he looks at Jesus and there's this encounter between the two of them. And I always say to the actors playing the two, I said, hold that for as long as you can. And there is something immensely powerful in that moment of Barabbas just realizing, I get who you are and I get that you've done this for me. So I'm going to play that clip for you now.
I shall release one of these two. Who shall it be? The man you claim is a blasphemer, or this murderer?
Free Barabbas. Punish Jesus.
I have done as you ask. This man is a threat to you and to Rome. This man must be punished.
He should be flogged. That is punishment enough.
Danger! Execution is the only punishment for his crime.
So that gives you a little bit of a sense of that moment. Now, again, it doesn't really translate particularly well when you're looking at it on a screen, but it gives you a flavour. What it also gives you a sense of is that style of the play. I said how we wanted it to be stylized. There is an intentionality behind every moment. It blurs the line, I would say, between film acting and stage acting. Stage acting, by its nature, has to be somewhat bigger, whereas film acting allows the camera to be used right in. It allows subtlety, it allows pause, it allows stillness in a way that stage acting just doesn't quite, I would say. And one thing we use constantly throughout the play is the use of pause, the use of stillness. I think I would often say to the actors, just leave it longer, just pause, don't rush it. Simon, would you like to say something about that at this point?
Yeah, I think that because of the size of the space, we were mic'd up throughout the performance. And what was very wonderful about that was the fact that quite a bit of the performing challenge was more of a vocal one. The idea of being able to do things in a more nuanced way. So you get more kind of light and shade with the different way that you can deliver different lines. So you're not just sort of belting it out, hopeful that the person sat right at the back can hear you, because some of the subtlety is taken away. But the way that the production is configured, you can have that kind of intimacy despite being in a really big space. And I think from a storytelling perspective, that's immense, particularly this story, where some of the words that are being spoken are among some of the most powerful words I've ever said, and so sort of impactful. So being able to do it in a filmic way, a semi-filmic way, really helps with storytelling. A huge technical challenge. We had two or three days of full-on technical rehearsals to attempt to achieve that. But it did feel quite strange going on to a performance and just being able to kind of speak without feeling the need to belt things out. And so it kind of gave you a different challenge. But I think it worked. It was crystal clear sound. People could hear what was going on.
I think the other thing it allows, stripping things back and taking the emotion out of it and adding weight, adding pause. You know, when you're working with a group of actors, some of whom have acted before, some of whom have never acted, that can feel, you know, the best possible light with amateur theatre, you can get widely varying ranges of ability. And that can sometimes feel as if it really jars. But what our technique and our style allowed us to do, it allowed everyone to kind of be at a baseline. Everyone was working at the same point, at the same level. There was no one who was particularly noticeably stronger versus someone who was noticeably particularly weak. And I felt that really worked effectively. If we just carry on, I started training for ordination in 2012. And we did the Cambridge Passion. I was training at Westcott House in Cambridge. Again, a very similar production. And these are people who are in the cast. They're my friends and ordinands. When we were at BBC Radio Cambridgeshire, who wanted to broadcast extracts from the play during Holy Week, which was great. I think the biggest discovery that came from the Cambridge Passion, or not discovery such, but the biggest thing I was aware of was the need to be so careful of anti-Semitism. Now, I was aware of that in the other two productions. But at Cambridge, I came into contact with Ed Kessler, who was he's a very well-known and respected Jewish scholar. And he was absolutely instrumental in the text in ensuring that any hint of anti-Semitism was avoided. I think sometimes passion plays fall into the trap of Jesus good, Jews bad, frankly. And that's horrific because it's a terribly, terribly distorted understanding. Well, it's not just distorted, it's an incorrect understanding of the gospel. And so I tried to ensure that the villains of the piece were the two religious leaders themselves, not the Jews as a people or as a nation, but the two religious leaders who were doing the reasoning for Jesus's death was done for political reasons. And that was just a kind of a challenge that we were constantly bearing in mind and constantly aware of. And even today, I don't think we still quite got the balance right. We did the Cambridge Passion. And then in 2016, 2017, we did the Hucknall Passion and the Hucknall Nativity. This is where I was curate. As you can see, we had a bit of a rebrand of the artwork. It was looking a bit tired, so we changed it. And then in 2019, just before the pandemic, when I was vicar of a church in Carrington in Nottinghamshire, we did the Carrington Nativity. And again, you can see the use of costumes. Just briefly to say a little bit about the technical side, and that gives a bit of a sense of the lighting. We didn't have any set. We built a stage, and the scenes was conveyed both through the music and the dialogue, but also through lighting. Lighting was an incredibly important part of it. I've not nearly always done the lighting myself. We've had companies come in and provide it, but I've normally always done the lighting, and a friend of mine has normally always done the sound. So there has been a slight flying by the seat of our pants feel to it. Next year, we're doing the Hereford Passion. And I basically said to the dean, said, can we have a bit more money so that I actually can hire professionals in to do the tech, because it's a massive headache. And God bless her, she said yes. So I can actually just be a director now rather than just having to worry about the technical on the night, which is a huge relief. One slight amusing story of when we did it, when we did the Nativity in Hucknall. In the past, I've often done the lighting and the music with my wife. I've normally done the lighting. She's been pressing the music on the laptop. But for whatever reason, I forget why, Rachel couldn't do this performance. So there was a lovely member of the congregation who was, I won't say her name, I don't want to embarrass her, who was doing the music for me. And I'd always said to the actors, if you get on stage and you forget what you're doing, just keep going. Don't acknowledge that you've made a mistake. We'll pick it up. You know, just, you know what the story is, just keep going. And this lovely lady who'd never been on stage before, I think she'd had a really tough day. I think she'd been to a funeral of a friend. And she got to the front of the stage, and I could see in her eyes, I thought, you're going to forget your line. And God bless her, she started to say the line, and then she said, oh, sorry. And in an absolute panic, I did what I normally do. I froze. And in horror, I grabbed Rachel's leg and squeezed it really hard to think, oh, no, what do we do? And it was at that point that I realized, oh, the leg of the person I've squeezed is not Rachel. She's not doing it tonight. It's this member of the congregation. And Rachel, who was sitting behind watching the show that night, said she just saw my friend's face, head go like this. Kind of in abject horror. So I turned and said, I'm really sorry. Please don't make that a safeguarding issue. I forgot you weren't my wife. So that's a slight aside. The other big discovery that came from Hucknall, in the middle of the production, we have a fight scene. In the Garden of Gethsemane, when Jesus is arrested, there is a fight scene. And a friend of mine who's a professional actress and professional fight coordinator has always set the fight for us. She was in the first two productions. We had this very stylized production where there is wait, where there is pause, and then suddenly out of nowhere, we have this burst of life, of aggression, of fighting, and then we kind of resume the style. And I could never quite work out what was wrong. It felt as if there was two styles that just didn't work. But then at Hucknall, I realized what wasn't working was because there was no rooting of the fight. This sudden burst of energy and life didn't feel rooted. And actually, we changed it. So the fight happened in slow motion with music over the top. And actually what it became Judas watching what was going on and what had done. And it was suddenly an insight into his character. And it's always been fascinating to me how different performances change the nature of the production. It's never fixed. And then finally, this year, we ended up doing the Nottingham Passion. So St. Mary's in the Lace Market is a church very close to my heart. It's a church I'd begun to know. I'd got some friends there. I'd been blessed and invited by Margaret and the vicar to help out and do stuff. And I think towards the end of last year, I said, what do you think about doing a passion play? One I'd done before, and God bless them. God bless the PCC. They completely welcomed me with open arms and gave me the budget and said, yep, let's do it. And we did. And we cast from across Nottingham. It's the biggest response we've had. We had two audition nights. It's the first time I've had to say to people, I'm sorry, there isn't a part for you. Made up of people from across Nottinghamshire, from across and Derbyshire, actually. People of faith, no faith. You see the top right hand corner, you'll see Simon and Aid. Aid is quite well known in Nottingham for being Nottingham's unofficial Judas. And this is a really interesting example as well, because Judas is a character. As a writer, why does Judas do what he does? You have to make some artistic decisions. And there's always a tension between staying true to the gospel, but also putting that artistic integrity, making those artistic decisions. Why does Judas betray Jesus? In the other productions, I've made Judas quite a sympathetic figure. when he goes to the Sanhedrin and they say, why are you doing this? He says, I'm tired. I'm so tired. He's almost a tragic figure. He's worn out. But when the beautiful performance Aid was doing fairly early on, I said to him, those lines don't fit anymore. They don't work with what you're doing. And I said, but I don't want you to change what you're doing because it's beautiful. And we changed it simply now to I've had enough. I've had enough. Just that subtle difference between I'm tired versus actually I'm just fed up with this now. And I think the skill of a good production is to adjust what you're doing to fit the actors. Don't make the actors fit into text that's already there. Be open. Let it be flexible. Let them bring to it. They're not just chess pieces. They are artistic people of their own. So anyway, some of those pictures give you a bit of a sense of what we're going to do or what we did rather. The response, again, that we had from Nottingham was amazing. We sold out about a month before performance, which was just extraordinary. And although we had a few cancellations, over two nights in this ancient historic church, we were sold out, 400 people each night. And again, we had people queuing up. So this is down into the lace market centre part of Nottingham. So that was on a Saturday night in Nottingham city centre. Really quite extraordinary. Really quite extraordinary. Why passion plays? What do they offer? They communicate the gospel in a way that is invitational. It's non-threatening. It has no expectations on people. People will come to see a play in a church in a way that they will never come to a Sunday morning service. As a priest, what I think we need to do is then follow those up. There needs to be an invitation back. There needs to be some sort of invitation to ongoing nurture or community. But I think the church has underestimated somewhat the importance and the power of drama in communicating what it is we believe. As I've always said as a slogan, for those who don't have faith, it's a great night out at the theatre. For those who do, it's an act of worship. And let me tell you, every time the crucifixion scene happened, every time Jesus walked past the lighting desk with his cross, I was lost in praise and thankfulness and worship. It was as real for me as the Eucharist is on a Sunday morning. And we had some really good press coverage. I'm going to try and show you a clip of some of the articles we had in a minute. But we had some really good press coverage. Although I do take issue with one reviewer who felt like they were reviewing a passion play that they'd wanted to see rather than the one they had seen, because they commented that they missed the visceral nature of a passion play, i.e. they wanted something, I don't want to say they wanted blood, guts and gore, but they wanted something that was a little bit earthier, a bit more real. And yet I remember watching Simon walk with his cross down to the back of the church, which is where the crucifixion took place. And I turned round and I saw one lady, I've never seen her before, and I assume she was with her husband. I hope it was her husband. And as Jesus went past, she had her head buried in his chest. She could not look at what was taking place. Now, if that's not visceral, if that's not a visceral reaction to what we're presenting, then I don't know what is. So don't underestimate the power of people's imagination. We don't need to show blood, guts and gore, as important as that is, as much as there is a place for the Mel Gibson's passions of this world. The power of people's imagination will do it for them. And what people imagine is often even more horrific than what they'll actually see on stage, because we know what we're seeing on stage is not real. We know it's not actually happening. But there's something about our imaginations making it real, and the imagination of creating that has an impact that what we could show never, I don't think, really works in the same way. Simon, is there anything you want to comment on about the Nottingham experience?
Yeah, I think as a rehearsal process as well, the production that we've seen Saturday, so we've got a lot about the audience perspective, but just as a process, putting the production together over the preceding 2 or 3 months, there were believers in the cast, there were non-believers, there were people of all types of faith and none. And I think actually just putting the show together as a process is in itself worshipful, because I've never really known any kind of, and I've done quite a lot of drama productions, but I've never really known a company of people that seem to be so completely focused on it from the very beginning. There was something very, very different about how it was working. And I think it was something to do with the surroundings. It was certainly to do with the power of the story. But as a process, if you're putting on a passion play, you are without trying to make this sort of an overblown thing, you carry the cast members along with you as well, and they will feel some degree of apprehension about what they're doing and how they're feeling. There are at least two people in the cast of the Nottingham Passion who had no faith at all, who had what they describe as spiritual experiences, which made them want to know more about the gospel as a consequence of having been involved in the process. And that was more than just acting the shows over that weekend. It was being part of the whole thing from the very beginning and looking at the characters in that story in ways that they'd not looked at them before. And I think if you've got a group of engaged performers who believe in the power of what it is that they're saying, and that comes through that performance, then I think something really powerful happens when it reaches an audience.
I think that's a really helpful point, Simon. And I think more than any other, that's probably not unfair to say, any piece of theatre stands or falls on the strength of the company. But I think even more so when it comes to a passion play, getting the casting right is absolutely fundamental, because what you're doing is you're trying to create an ensemble. And it's an ensemble of people who are committed to telling the story, as opposed to it being a showcase for my own individual talent, my own individual merit. And creating that ensemble, I always say what happens in the pub after a rehearsal is as important as what happens in the rehearsal itself, because it's there that friendships are made, that bonds are forged, and it's there that it moves away from it being about me and it becomes something bigger. Now, that's true of all theatre, but I think it's especially true of a passion where we're telling this greatest story of all. So what I'm going to do, just before we have a break, I'm going to show you, we were featured on Nottingham East Midlands today, which is always a little bit, it's always quite nice to get on the telly, isn't it? I'm just going to show you the clip there.
An Easter passion play performed inside a church was so successful it had sold out a month before the performance. It's delighted the people behind the production, who now believe it suggests Nottingham could become a centre of religious theatre. Nicola Gilwarren reports.
It's billed as the greatest story ever told of betrayal, suffering, and redemption. And audiences flock to see the Nottingham Passion at St Mary's Church in the city, selling out a month before opening night.
I think all of us, including me, were really gobsmacked as to that happening. That's just a wonderful thing. And I believe it's touching some sort of nerve. It's meeting some sort of need for people. There's some sort of desire. People are coming to, they're paying to come to see a faith-based play. And even those who don't have faith know that it is representing something of faith.
Now, those behind the production want more.
There's no reason why Nottingham, as a historic city, shouldn't have a regular production of the mysteries or the passion plays into the future, like Chester or York. So if we can be instrumental in setting that up as a bit of cultural regeneration for this great city, then I'd be proud to be part of it.
We need to be doing more stuff in spaces like this, in particular, around biblical storytelling, because these are stories which are accessible to all people, irrespective of their faith position.
I think the church can use it a lot more than it does to reach people, to teach people, to bring communities together. And I think theatre as a medium, especially in a historical city like Nottingham, is crying out for this kind of creative medium to explore stories, communities, issues. And yeah, absolutely, we need to be doing more of it.
The will is certainly here to resurrect the retelling of Bible stories, and those here say that so are the audiences. Nicola Gilroy, BBC East Midlands Today, Nottingham.
We were really chuffed with that. Really nice interview to have. Certainly my dream, and had I stayed in Nottingham, I would love to have explored some sort of Christian theatre company that not just told biblical stories, but they used theatre to explore the gospel. As I said, next year at Hereford, we're hoping to do the Hereford Passion. We're currently calling out for actors, so do pray for that for us. But my hope is that from that, some sort of Christian theatre initiative or mission will develop. Because as I said, I think the power of theatre and communicating what it is we believe, and just kind of leaving it there, just saying, this is what we believe, What do you think? Come and see, as Christ, as the gospel says. I think that's such a powerful thing, full of potential.